Yeah, he sort of is the founding father of physics, basically. So, and you can't really get much bigger deal than that for a physicist or an astronomer. He really was the man who invented the whole subject.
Oh, he's a big deal because he's the first person to actually use mathematics and develop mathematics so that you could create a theory, work out the consequences and compare with experiment. So, for example, his three laws can be expressed mathematically, turned into equations, and then you find out that the planets go round in ellipses with the sun at one of the focuses, foci of the ellipse.
Sir Isaac Newton is thought to be one of the greatest scientists of all time, has contributed a lot to the field. He developed calculus, he invented a reflecting telescope that was made from a mirror instead of a lens.
He's sometimes credited with having invented the reflecting telescope, which isn't true. In fact, lots of people have sort of played around with them. Even Galileo, the first person to use one astronomically, had actually played around trying to make telescopes out of mirrors. But Newton's great genius is that he actually built a practical one, one that actually worked.
What Newton did was incredible. And a lot of the things that he came up with, the basis of understanding. For example, when he was a student, there were light beams going through the shutters of his window, and he put it through a prism and showed that light split into the spectrum. And as a result of that, he could explain why rainbows came about. And he was able to turn the mathematics and do the experiments so as to analyze the natural world in a way nobody had done before.
But he was a bit of a strange character. He wasn't an extrovert. He didn't really get along with people very well.
I've read that he had a couple of nervous breakdowns. He was a very, very sensitive person. So when the calculus, this mathematics, came up, he and Leibniz both invented complementary aspects to it. And he couldn't see that Leibniz's works on the integral calculus was complementary to his work on the differential calculus. He just wanted to rubbish Leibniz all his life. And so it was a competition, and he was very arrogant and aggressive about things like that. Also with Robert Hooke, who was a wonderful experimentalist and wrote the standard treatise on optics, he was an enemy as far as Newton was concerned, and he would try to do anything to damage Hooke's reputation. So he wouldn't be a nice colleague to have.
One of the things that Newton is most famous for is saying that, you know, if he's seen further than anybody else, it was only because he was standing on the shoulders of giants. And this was always viewed as a kind of self-deprecating remark that he was actually, you know, showing respect to those who had come before him. More recently, it's been suggested actually he was just having a go at Hooke, who was famously very short. And so there are aspects of him. He was a little bit strange. He was not necessarily a particularly nice man. He was incredibly secretive. He would keep stuff hidden away for years and years just because he was afraid that other people were going to steal his ideas.
But he was a scientist through and through, and he used himself to experiment with a lot of different projects. So when he was working with lenses and mirrors and optics, he actually wondered why our eyes are such sophisticated lenses. And so he actually took an ice pick and kind of probed behind his eye to figure out how it worked so well. It's kind of gross. I hate that story.
Isaac Newton's a fascinating character because he's famous for writing the Principia Mathematica, which certainly changed the face of physics. But Newton wrote more about theology and prophecy and alchemy than he ever did about science and mathematics. And that's an extraordinary thing. And Newton had some very, very eccentric theological views about Christianity.
Isaac Newton also liked to look at the sun to see how that affected your eyes. So of course, as children, we all hear, don't look at the sun too long because you'll go blind. Well, he did actually look at the sun for quite a long time, and then he remarked in his journal that he saw the image of the sun in his eye while he was sleeping, or rightly, he was going to sleep even for about 3 days. So it's definitely does damage to your eye, believe it.
But Newton also rejected the traditional Christian view that God is not just an individual, but God is a community of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we call that the Trinity, three persons in one God. And Newton rejected the view of the church that God is Trinity. It's ironic because Newton was a fellow of Trinity College, Cambridge. So in his very working environment, the institution that he worked for was dedicated to a doctrine, a teaching in which he himself did not believe.
Well, when I first came to Nottingham, I live way out in Lincolnshire, and somebody told us that his house was at Woolthorpe, near Colsterworth, and we drove out there, and I got the wrong Woolthorpe. There are two out there. eventually we found the right one. And there, in those days, this is over 30 years ago, it was the house was owned by somebody, and you had to go at a certain time, and she'd open the door for you. You can go around and see all the traces he'd left behind, because he got his compasses and scratched pictures of the cathedral in Grantham on the wall. So I remember that vividly.
Gradually, this aura came to settle around Newton, that he was the holder of secrets, and that the Principia was, as it were, this was Newton's scripture. And Newton himself fostered this reputation for being some sort of prophet of God. And he did write under some pseudonyms, one of which was the pseudonym Jehovah Sanctus Unus. Jehovah, the name of God, the Holy One, which he believed was an anagram of the Latin version of his own name. Isaacus Newtonus, Jehovah's Sanctus Unus.
I thought a manor house would be a big Elizabethan manor, but it's actually a small, pokey little place. It's not much bigger than an ordinary semi, only on one floor, or maybe two floors. It wasn't that grand.
I mean, think of the Da Vinci Code today and Dan Brown. I mean, there's nothing new in all that. Is there something we're not being told? It's a bit like a conspiracy theory. And can we get underneath it all? And just as Newton thought that he was trying to decode the universe, the mind of God, by this mathematics, so he thought that there were all other codes all over the place, including his own name and anagrams, that needed decoding to see what they revealed. So knowledge had to be prized open to get the secrets, and only the very clever, only the wise could really find out exactly what was going on in the mind of God.
He was, you know, he had the all the trappings of a genius, in the sense that, as well as being incredibly smart and coming up with incredibly innovative ideas, he also clearly had his eccentricities as well.
Would you give him a job here?
That's a good question. I wonder how he would succeed in academia today. I don't know, is the short answer. A lot of the things that you know, these eccentricities, the way he tended to rub people up the wrong way, the fact that he didn't publish things, he hid them away for years at a time. You know, in academia today, the way you succeed is by getting your ideas out there and by publishing things and showing your peers, your fellow scientists, what you're doing. His approach to science of keeping stuff very much to himself and not wanting to share it with people really wouldn't work terribly well in the way that science works today.
He was really quite phenomenal in his prime, and later on he dabbled in alchemy and all sorts of things and got into religious arguments. He was a very strange and complicated person, not the sort that you want to go down the pub with.
I'd go to the pub with him.
And then you'd start arguing in your Australian way to wind him up and see what you get out of him, so you could do a video for 60 symbols.
If I could make a video of Isaac Newton, Roger, I wouldn't be sitting here with you.
Quite.